From Philharmonic Hall in Lincoln Center, home of the world's greatest musical events, another program of New York Philharmonic Young People's Concerts, under the musical direction of Leonard Bernstein. And here is Leonard Bernstein.
My dear young friends, I am happy and proud to welcome you to our 10th season of Young People's Concerts. Imagine, it's been a whole decade we've been playing and talking about music for you, and I don't know how much you've actually learned, but I like to think we must be doing something right because it's our 10th season. And to add to the festivities, this is also the first season in which all our programs will be seen on television in color, which is why I've got this modishly colorful tie on. And that brings us to our subject. What is a mode? Well, for one thing, musical modes have nothing to do with neckties or dresses or even with fashions of a musical kind. Modes are simply scales, though not perhaps those very scales you practice on your piano. They're rather special scales, and I wouldn't have dreamed of bothering you with them except for an incident that happened a few months ago. My 14-year-old daughter, Jamie, happened to ask me one day why a certain Beatles song had such funny harmony. She couldn't seem to find the right chords for it on her guitar. And I began to explain to her that the song was modal. That is, it was based on what is called a mode. And I went on to show her the chords that came from that mode, and she got so excited she wanted to know more and more about it, till finally she said, why not tell all this on a young people's program? Nobody ever heard of modes. Well, I thought Jamie is just a natural music lover with the usual weekly piano lesson, and if she finds this material fascinating, why shouldn't you? So here goes, and you can blame it all on Jamie.
Welcome once again to The Radical Imagination. I'm your host, Jim Vrettos. I'm a sociologist who's taught at John Jay College and Yeshiva University here in New York. One of the key questions we discuss on the show and ask people about is where and how they develop their radical imagination. The answers are as wide and diverse as the people we've had on the show, and as broad and different as the people who listen to it. A few things stand out, though. One's radical imagination seems to be a passion that comes out of a love and creative hunger to express and know more about the world, more about a particular subject, more about people, more about life. For me, it began to surface as a child through music. I was extraordinarily fortunate to have a mother who was an artist and a pianist. Music was always in the house while my mother painted, while I played, throughout the day and evening. Much of the music was classical, but all kinds of music from all corners of the world were played and heard. At 4 or 5 years old, I begged my mother to give me piano lessons, and she said, happily, yes. She didn't need to force me. It was a natural progression from the joy I experienced as a child listening and taking in the beautiful, intriguing sounds I heard from her own playing, the radio, and our stereo. And when I was 11, a program began to air on television called Young People's Concerts, with the New York Philharmonic. The narrator and conductor was a riveting and mesmerizing figure. You couldn't take your eyes off him, you couldn't close your ears, mind, or heart to him. Every New York City public school kid was watching it. It was a rite of passage, like going to see the grand blue whale model of the American Museum of Natural History, or a school field trip to the Haydn Planetarium, or rooting for the Yankees, or Dodgers, or Giants. The maestro was Leonard Bernstein, and my own radical imagination soared to new heights I never knew was in me. To now have on the show the eldest daughter of Maestro Bernstein, 60 years after that first Young People's Concert, is beyond my wildest and fondest imagination. She's a writer, narrator, broadcaster, and filmmaker, and the author of a critically acclaimed book called Famous Father Girl, a memoir of growing up Bernstein. We see her famous father through a daughter's eyes, a loving and unsettling portrait. Welcome, Jamie. Jamie Bernstein, it was your fault, right? That's what your father said about the mode.
The mode thing.
The mode thing. But welcome again to the Radical Imagination. Thank you so much for being here. And tell us about the Young People's Concert and this clip we just seen about the mode and blame it on Jamie.
Right. Well, I'll tell you that my memory of this mode business is different from what my father described. My memory is that it was after one of the Young People's Concerts, and my brother and I had been there with our dad all day long watching them put the whole show together, which was one of our favorite things to do. It was very interesting to watch the whole show being put together. And we all got in the car with our dad, and he immediately turned on the radio like he always did, and he would say, "Let's catch up," and put on the pop station, because he loved the Beatles and Motown and the Rolling Stones, and so we listened to all that pop music together.
But rather than he didn't turn on the classical station.
This
was the pop station.
And
you're a rock
Well, I was a Beatlemaniac.
Right? Beatlemaniac. You were okay.
The Beatles were the most important thing in the world to me in those days.
Okay.
So it happened that the song by the Kinks, "You Really Got Me," came on the radio.
I remember it.
One of our favorites. Remember? Yeah.
Girl, you got me, girl,
you really got me going.
Now.
You got me so I can sleep at night. Loved it.
Yep.
We all loved it. My dad loved it too.
Mm-hmm.
So he says, "Hey, you know, that song's in the Mixolydian mode. Do you know what a mode is?" No, my brother and I did not, of course. So he proceeded to start explaining modes to us right there in the car on the way to Connecticut. And when we got to the house, he took us straight over to the piano and then showed us the different scales of the of the different modes.
Wow.
That's how we found out what modes were. And sure enough, what was his next Young People's Concert about? Modes. So, and this happened a lot. Because
that happened a lot with you in your
He used my brother and sister and me as guinea pigs for a lot of his Young People's Concert scripts and ideas. He would try things out on us. So that's how I recall it all happening. But anyway, you are correct that the Young People's Concerts had this tremendous impact on more than one generation of viewers.
Absolutely.
And in New York City, of course, it was even more memorable for everybody because it was, as you said, the hometown team. You know, the New York Philharmonic was right there in Lincoln Center.
It was the equivalent of the Beatles.
Sort of, in
that sense.
Or the equivalent of, as you say, like a ball team.
Yeah,
it was, you know, your local
It was that exciting
gang.
And riveting, absolutely.
Right. But the whole country got to tune in and learn about classical music through the New York Philharmonic and my father and his amazing scripts that he wrote himself and his amazing ability to seem to jump right out of the TV screen and be right there with you. So you talk about the radical imagination.
Mm-hmm.
My father had that radical imagination just to the max.
He had that
ferocious curiosity, not just about music, but about everything. Literature and history and science and math and art and anything you could think of. He was just, you know, devoured by curiosity. And then the thing was, the minute he learned about anything that he was excited about, he had to turn right around and share it with somebody else. And that's why he was such an effective teacher, because you could feel his excitement, you know, just jumping out at you as if he were tugging you on the sleeve. Listen to this.
We feel his presence here at this moment. Where did he get this incredible energy, this life force? What about his own background? I mean,
I think we have to just say that it was a kind of piece of magic and an accident of fate and DNA, I don't know.
Because his family, his father and mother were rather, stayed?
Well, his father had a burning curiosity, but about only one thing, and that was the Talmud. My grandfather, Sam, was a Talmudic scholar in every spare moment that he had in his life. But he was actually, by day, he was a businessman. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he is the classic immigrant success story. He escaped the pogroms
from Russia.
In Russia, Ukraine, came over without a kopeck in his pocket, got here and struggled along and found distant relatives and managed to kind of strive and scramble and eventually was able to start his very own hair and beauty supply business in Boston. The Samuel J. Bernstein Hair Company in Boston. It's Bernstein.
Right.
That was the slogan. And so you can imagine how...
That's the actual... So in Boston, it's Bernstein.
That was the slogan
that he created.
So you can imagine how proud Sam was to be able to hand over his successful hair and beauty supply business to his eldest son, Leonard, to run.
Yeah.
That was the absolute capper on his successful immigrant experience.
We need to bring that out, too, today, as we have a president who is sending 5,200, not reserve, active military troops to our southern border, basically to confront, if you will, thousands of desperately poor people coming to our southern border, mainly women and children. So, I mean, that has to be emphasized again with, you know, your own grandfather's experience coming here and how all of us were immigrants.
Well, I think we can safely say that most of us would not be here if our current president were to actually be able to enact this change in the laws, which he's not able to do with a stroke of his pen as he wished he could. We would all have to leave because if he had it his way, anyone who was born here whose parents weren't born here would have to be ejected. It's so unthinkable. Anyway, it's not
even... We'll get back to that, too, the political sense.
Right. But anyway,
go ahead. Yes.
You had a very different childhood experience from my dad. You were encouraged in your artistry, whereas my dad was actively discouraged by his father because in the old country, being a musician, a klezmer, was basically the, you know, just half
now
a
for
step...
For our audience, klezmer is... Jewish blues?
I will explain.
Please.
Well, a musician in the old country, the nickname for that kind of a musician was a klezmer. And what a klezmer basically was in the old country, a musician was kind of a vagrant, a homeless guy with a fiddle who trudged from village to village, from shtetl to shtetl, and played his fiddle at weddings and bar mitzvahs. And
fiddler on the roof.
Okay. And so they, you know, they would give him a bowl of cabbage soup and a couple of coins and see you later. Then he would get back on the road and trudge to the next village. So you call that a living?
Right.
That's, you know, so of course my grandfather's experience of what a musician was meant that he was certainly not going to encourage his son to be a musician.
He sweat and
this is not what he went through
for.
He, you know, he didn't go through steerage and come over here with no money and strive and work at the Fulton Fish Market and you know, all the horrible things that
and to set
he
up this empire
do.
for Leonard here
for his son to be a musician. That's not why he went to all this trouble.
So
the story goes that at one point Sam actively discouraged his son from being a musician by refusing to pay for his piano lessons. And so my father taught other kids in the neighborhood how to play the piano and made his money that way, and that was how he paid for the piano lessons. So many years later, when he was 25 years old, and my father had this Cinderella-like overnight success by having to take over conducting the New York Philharmonic at the last minute, and it was a national radio broadcast, and he became famous overnight. Mm-hmm. Some journalist got wind of this story about my grandfather, and he confronted my grandfather, Sam, and said, "Is it true that you wouldn't pay for your son's piano lessons?"
Yeah.
And Sam Bernstein famously replied, "Well, how was I supposed to know he'd turn out to be Leonard Bernstein?"
Oh, brother.
It's a true story.
So that's a lot to deal with there, okay? A lot to deal with.
But sometimes when something is being kept away from you and you really want it, it makes you want it more. So maybe it actually ended up giving my father even more determination to be a musician, precisely because his father was trying to prevent him.
Where did he study?
He had piano lessons as a kid.
Right.
And then he went to Harvard and had a regular liberal arts education.
Right.
And then after that, he spent 2 years at Curtis Institute of Music in Philadelphia. Mm-hmm. And that concluded his music education.
Interesting.
At Curtis, he was studying piano and conducting, not composing. He actually never officially studied composition, but he had composing mentors. And probably the most important one of all was his very close friend and mentor, Aaron Copland.
Aaron Copland. So conducting came easy, or easier than composing?
Oh, I don't know. I mean, I think he had a huge aptitude for both of them.
For both, okay.
But I think, in a way, composing was harder because it was lonelier. And the thing my father hated most of all in this world, next to injustice, was solitude. He really didn't like to be alone. Hmm. And so composing was hard and lonely work for him. That's why I think he enjoyed writing Broadway shows so much, and ballets and operas and anything that involved collaboration.
Yeah.
Because that way he had company and it was a less lonely task.
Maybe it goes back, I don't know, to the Talmudic scholar alone musing over these eternal truths. He wanted to express it, externalize it maybe through the music and joining with other people and enjoying that.
Well, he was all about people.
He was all about
people. He would be the first to say. He loved people and he loved connecting and communicating.
And he loved your family. He loved you. I mean, right?
But yeah.
And you've got this incredible book where you show us over and over again where that love, how that love is expressed. It's not at all times conventional. How would you describe it growing up in that?
Well, episode? I guess you're right that it wasn't conventional. And you know, every family has its ups and downs.
Of course.
And in our family, because my father was such a luminary, I guess everything was just written a little brighter, a little larger, but it had all the same essential ingredients that most families have. You know, and I credit our mother, Felicia Montealegre, who came from Chile in South America. I credit her with creating the stability and the delicious, happy, warm environment that kept our family so happy and healthy. My father, you know, was so all over the place. His energy was so on rocket fuel all the time that he really needed a stabilizing influence in his life.
She was it.
And she really provided that.
And
we all
felt
it. And
for you too, right? You felt it also.
We all felt it, yeah.
We felt it. Well, after all, I mean, he's the conductor. He's the maestro. He's the guy.
He was a maestro.
The orchestra. Yeah. So did he carry that over into his family life? Or did he?
Well, I mean, you know, this is a guy who couldn't stop teaching, who couldn't stop communicating. And so he was like this all the time, even at home, like the thing with the modes.
Yeah,
he
yeah.
just had to explain. He had to go to the piano and share. And he was always...
Maybe the Talmudic tradition there, right? No?
Very much in the old Talmudic tradition. And his grandfather was like that too. His joke with his brother and sister was that their father, Sam, if you were at the dinner table with Sam and you said, "Sam, could you please pass the salt?" Sam would say, "Funny thing about salt, you know, Lot's wife in the Bible," and then he'd be off on some story.
Yeah.
So they all made fun of Sam for being that way, but actually my father was even more that way than Sam was.
With
no
music.
Matter what the topic was, it would set him off. So my sister Nina always says, you had to be really careful about what question you asked our father, because if it was too juicy a question, the answer was going to be an hour long. And that's just the way our dad was.
And your mom also helped create this environment of this salon type environment. So you had people coming and going. And arguing,
my mother
and debating,
herself was
an activist.
She was a pianist.
Pianist.
And an actress and an activist.
Okay.
So she overlapped so much in her sensibilities with our dad. But the thing she had that he did not have was a fantastic eye for design and a kind of genius for making an environment delicious. And that's the thing that she did in our house. And that's why everybody always wanted to come over to our house, because it was fun there. It was warm and inviting. The furniture and the decor and the art and everything was beautiful, but not fancy.
Yeah. Comfortable,
you would always feel like it was perfectly okay to hook your knee around the arm of the sofa. Like, everybody felt so comfortable there, and the food was great because my mother from South America always made sure that we had a cook who was from South America, usually from Chile. And so we had all this delicious food. Everybody wanted to come to our house, and they did.
Yeah.
And such people, because my parents were at the epicenter of this amazing cultural environment in New York City in the middle of the 20th century, where there was just so much going on, and the people were amazing, and there they all were showing up at our house. And of course, I was just a little kid. I didn't know that Mike Nichols and Richard Avedon and Steve Sondheim were all incredible people. I just thought they were my parents' friends, and I liked them a lot. But it was only later that I realized that they were luminaries unto themselves.
Setting the tone for an entire country and culture, and here, you know, and your father in the middle of this as well, and you become part of this mix as well. A lot of pressure or fun combination?
Well, at first it was just fun. There was no pressure. As I say, you know, our family was just our family. When you're a kid, you have nothing to compare it to. Mm. It's just your personal home environment.
You accept it.
And we had all these wonderful people around all the time, and they were fun, and they were hilarious, and there was music all the time, and there were, you know, charades and joke telling and reciting of poetry and word games. And so it was a fantastic environment to grow up in for a long time. And then things got more complicated later.
Later meaning what time?
Well, I will tell you, when I look back at my childhood, there is a day when the shadows fell. And that day was November 22nd, 1963, the day JFK was assassinated. Before that day, I can't really say I ever saw my parents cry or any grown-ups cry.
Yeah.
It was all kind of a sort of happy, fun-loving environment with a lot of warmth and energy and all that good stuff, which certainly didn't go away entirely. But that was the day when I realized that being a grown-up was more complicated than I thought it was.
The end of innocence. The end of innocence.
Yeah.
We're going to show a clip in a little bit about your father conducting Shostakovich's Fifth and the passion and the emotion that was going on there. So let's play it and love your comments on this.
Thank you.
Wow.
I'm speechless. I hope you're not. It just goes beyond words. I mean, the face, the expression, the ecstasy. I mean,
can you imagine what a fun job that is?
Whoa, that's a lot of fun.
Yeah, I think that, and you know.
That's a lot of fun.
It took a lot of time away from his composing. He always complained. But when you see that, you can see why he had to keep going back and doing that.
Oh, yeah. I mean, absolutely. I mean, I can't imagine how much fun he must have been having there and just living life to the fullest of emotions.
You know, I always think that it's so perfect that that job is called being a conductor, because it really is like an electrical circuit where the energy flows from the orchestra to the audience through the conductor in a circuit.
Absolutely.
It's really a kind of electrical energy that goes around in a circle.
Great way of expressing
it. Through the conductor.
Now, you were striving for a musical career yourself?
I wrestled with that.
You wrestled with it.
So, I mean, imagine growing up with that.
I can't.
I was, you know, musical myself, are my brother and sister.
I'm sure.
But it was always a conflict for me. Comparisons are odious. And I could see that, you know, he was at a level of musicianship that I could not hope to begin to approach. And yet, I loved making music myself, and I wrote songs on piano and guitar, and I just couldn't let it go. So I did pursue it for quite a few years. I moved out to L.A. to get my record deal as a singer-songwriter, and I shopped my tapes around, as we used to do back in the day.
And he was supportive of that, wasn't he?
He was supportive, but I think that there was a kind of unspoken understanding that, you know, well, whatever you do as a musician is certainly not going to be at the level of what I'm doing over here. He never said such a thing, but
I
felt it, I think. Anyway, I beat my head against that for many years, and then finally set it aside and had my family, raised my family instead.
Okay. And you've written this terrific book.
Well, and what the book is quite a bit of the book is about how I finally made my peace with music, because I did struggle over it. And, you know, I loved music and I loved making music, but I was always kind of in agony. And the image that I use in the book is that I had one foot on the gas and the other foot on the brake at the same time. So my energy was always being blocked by my own self. And it wasn't really until I stopped making music with my own body that I got calmer and out of my own way. And luckily, I stumbled upon this very satisfactory solution, compromise, which was to talk about music, to write about music. And so what I do is I narrate concerts, not unlike my father's young people's concerts, except I don't do the conducting part, but I do the talking part and the writing part.
Let's get back to in just a minute, because as you were talking about the accelerator and the brake here, tell us about this excerpt you have in the book where you are going out with your father, other friends at the disco, and he takes you by the hand. They're playing Zorba the Greek, from Zorba the Greek. So talk about taking the break off and that incredible energy that you then were dancing with him and then with the...
Okay, well...
Tell us a little about that.
Well, I think we can safely say that my father never stepped on the self-break in his life.
Right.
Okay.
And neither did Zorba, for that matter. All right, he was...
But yeah, okay. Well, there is that very outgoing personality that is just exuberant and is just out there just throwing themselves into the world.
Absolutely.
So we were actually at the ski resort of Vail, Colorado, back when it was first beginning in the 60s. And there was a disco there, so we all went with our friends that we were staying with. My father and my brother and myself were on this trip. And we all went to Casino Vail, it was called, if memory serves. Mm. And at some point, they put on the Zorba the Greek tune, you know, the bouzouki number.
Yeah.
And it gets faster and faster, and then it goes full tilt into that next section.
So like shuts the coverage here.
Well, very exuberant and fun. And of course, my father couldn't control himself, and he started dancing like mad and dragged me to dance with him. And then for some reason, everybody else in the disco made a circle around us and started clapping in rhythm to us dancing. So I found myself stuck in the middle of this circle dancing with my father at the age of 14, when these things 14. Are very embarrassing. And when it got really embarrassing was when my father got down on his knees and took out his handkerchief and started twirling it over his head. And what could I do but sort of dance around him in a little circle, and everybody's clapping and screaming, and it was the most embarrassing thing that ever happened to me ever.
Really?
So up to that moment,
up to that moment. So he was showing a sort of exuberance that was also uncomfortable.
For me, not for him.
Not for him, but...
It was just a thing he might do. I mean, it was, you know, for him, it was just his way of being at the center of attention in an exuberant way, and he was loving the music and loving the moment and probably very much enjoying sharing it with his poor, mortified daughter.
So
He meant no harm.
He meant no harm, okay. Are there other examples where you felt that as well?
Well, there are innumerable examples of times when my father's exuberance would go over the top and embarrass us all in the family. And I recount many of such incidents in my book, sure.
Sure. And but again, it's more, well, this is our father that you accept, but it's at times it's difficult and embarrassing. It can be.
Yeah, well, he was a handful. He was larger than life.
Larger than life.
And this is what happens in a family when one of the family members is larger than life. You as a family and as individual members of the family have to figure out a way to navigate. And
he's a genius, if you will. And I mentioned you before the show, my dear friend, who's now passed on, Eugene Fodor, world famous virtuoso violinist, reminds me a little bit also of the exuberance, I mean, the life force that he was too, that became at times also. I mean, we'd had food fights in restaurants. I mean, and worse. Okay, but the point is, it's a larger than life figure that one comes to grips with, and as you say now, you're at peace with the compromises that you made in your life. Is that toward music? So let's get back to some of the work that you're now doing that. That's in a way carrying on that tradition, the Young People's Concert.
It does carry on that tradition, and it turns out that if I inherited anything from my dad, it's this love of communicating.
Yeah.
I have that a lot myself. And
that's
so
obvious in the show here.
I really enjoy getting up, especially in front of an audience of young people, and telling them about music. And I do this all over the place, not just about my dad. I talk about all kinds of composers and musical topics. And I love doing it. I write the script myself. I research the topic. Then I squeeze all that information down into a user-friendly
Just like your narration. Dad, just like your dad did.
Yeah, just like my dad. I just don't do the music part.
You don't, right.
But and that works very well for me because it still keeps me in the world of music. It means that I'm with musicians, I'm at orchestra rehearsals, I'm hanging out afterwards with the musicians, I'm traveling and seeing the world and talking to the audience members, all that fun stuff.
Now, is this classical music that you're, all kinds of music you're talking about?
It's mainly,
give us an example.
Well, I'll give you an example.
Yeah.
Well, there's a wonderful young orchestra in Miami Beach called the New World Symphony that was started by Michael Tilson Thomas, and it's kind of an orchestral academy. And these are very young musicians fresh out of conservatory, so it's like a farm team for professional orchestras, and a lot of them are picked off by the scouts and become members of the professional orchestras all around the country. So they're really good musicians and they're just starting out. So the atmosphere down there is fantastic. And I was invited to do two concerts a year that were just an hour long, like the young people's concerts, but for adult audiences. And sometimes I would choose the subject and sometimes they would. So it could be anything from, I had one called Romeo's and Juliet's, where I talked about different orchestral pieces that were inspired by Romeo and Juliet. So there's the fantastic fantasy by Tchaikovsky, which is the big, that has that big loved tune that we all know.
Right?
And then there's a really good Prokofiev ballet of Romeo and Juliet that has fantastic music. And there is also, of course, West Side Story, which was composed by my dad and is inspired, is based on Romeo and Juliet. It tells the same story except modernized with street gangs in New York City. So we put in some of that music too. So that's just one example of a concert I did down there. I did one about Stravinsky, and I did one about Russian music, and I did one about Richard Strauss' Death and Transfiguration. So you see there's like a big, big, you know, diversity of topics. And it was such fun to put them together.
I bet. And have you, you mentioned about West Side Story now, but have you set aside a lecture or many on your father's work?
I give many talks about my dad's music, and I certainly do one about West Side Story, many in fact.
And tell us a little about that.
I would love to, but you know, you have to, like my father, watch out what you ask me, because I'll talk for 20 minutes.
We've got a little time, here.
I'll tell you just the one essential thing about West Side Story that is so cool is that three notes are the key to the entire West Side Story score. And they are the first three notes of the show. Ba-da-dum, which is also the Jets whistle. It's how the gang signals to each other. They whistle it. I can't whistle very well. But anyway, those three notes are also the key to the entire score of West Side Story. Ba ba ba, and it, what are those three notes? It's a C and an F sharp and a G. Ba ba ba, if you anagram them. And so, ba da ba can also be spelled ba ba ba, which becomes Maria, one of the most famous songs from West Side Story. And it also becomes boy, boy, crazy boy, the cool number.
Right.
So it's that those three notes, you find them all over the score, in all these different transfigurations and permutations, just like Beethoven took ba 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 and used that all the way through the Fifth Symphony. So my father took classical music building blocks and used them in a Broadway score. And the thing that's so cool about those three notes is that that weird note in the middle, ba ba ba, is called a tritone. It's a weird interval. It makes, the three notes don't make a normal triad, like a normal major chord would be ya ba ba, a normal minor chord would be ya ba ba, but ya ba ba is neither fish nor fowl. Used to be called the devil's interval. It's considered like weird and maybe a little wicked or something back in the day. So the weirdness of that tritone it always
jarring.
Wants
it's
to go.
It's jarring.
It's jarring and unsettled.
Unsettled.
And
yeah.
it wants to settle somewhere else. It wants to either be a major chord or a minor chord. So it acts as a fulcrum that the entire score balances on. It's trying to go to the major chord of the young lovers and the happiness, or it's trying to go to the dissonance and the unhappiness and the minor chord of the street gang
Living
violence.
On the edge. Fiddler on the Roof.
Yeah, it's all that's about living on the edge too.
Wow. I mean, keep going on. I mean, I'm just, I can listen to you. No, this is.
Don't get me started.
No, no, I've got you started. Look, I'm back, whatever it was, 10,
well, I'll tell you, the wonderful thing about West Side Story for my dad is that it was one of his most magnificent ways of using music to try and make the world a better place, which is something that he did all his life. He was as much an activist as he was an artist. And when he could do both at the same time, that's when he was most fulfilled. So in West Side Story, this is, you know, one of the ultimate tellings of how love tries to triumph over hatred and violence and intolerance, and you know, all these
and the immigrant experience,
all these issues that I am very sorry to say are with us to this very day. West Side Story is as relevant and up to the minute today as it was when it was written back in 1957.
And we were thrilled to have Bobby Sanabria on the show here.
My pal.
Right, my pal. And he, after the show we did here a few months ago, I guess, he said, get a hold of Jamie.
Well, his way of having reimagined West Side Story for his Latin American orchestra, it's the greatest thing ever, I think. I just love it. He's quite a genius himself.
Absolutely.
That
we spent a whole show on him.
And Bobby and I have talked a lot about what would my dad be saying if he were here today. And
tell us.
Well, I think he'd be out in the streets making a racket, you know, putting on concerts to raise money for, you know, the people who lost their homes in Puerto Rico last year.
Right.
And I actually went to a concert performance of West Side Story in Philadelphia last year. Mm-hmm. And when they got to this line, nobody knows in America, Puerto Rico's in America, the conductor, Yannick Nézet-Séguin, stopped the music dead. And there was this gigantic silence. Yeah. And the whole audience went, and then people started applauding. It was such a dramatic moment. So West Side Story can still tell our modern stories for us today.
Absolutely, absolutely. Now, during the 60s and 70s, with the political turmoil, there was this movement also to, I mean, a lot of stuff was going on, the radical politics, radical chic. I brought that up.
I
just want to bring that up a little bit, but the political activism, so much was being talked about there, with Black Panthers and Young Lords, white radicals, SDS, progressive of all sorts, trying to mold and build a radical imagination. I was involved in some of those efforts at Columbia as a graduate student. We've had students here. We've had Mark Rudd on the show. We've had a number of other people, progressives and radicals from that period. So your father also got involved in this. And what was this fundraiser that occurred at your the house?
Well, the most misunderstood occasion in my family's history.
To talk about
Briefly,
sure.
It was my mother's effort. My father had nothing to do with this event. It was my mother who was very involved with the Committee for Public Justice, which was a subsidiary of a larger organization that was doing a lot of work at the time for social justice. And so she was encouraged to hold a fundraiser to raise money to help the families of these incarcerated Black Panther members who were waiting for their trial. And they had been arrested on these trumped up charges of supposedly, you know, planning to blow up Bloomingdale's, or it was all complete nonsense. And the entire thing was thrown out by the judge on the first day of the trial. But meanwhile, they're stuck in jail waiting for this trial to come around, and how were the families going to subsist? So my mother was trying to raise some money to help the families, you know, stay fed and clothed and get the kids to school and, you know, just stay alive. And also
benign and humane.
Benign and humane.
Right.
Which is what my mother was.
Felicia. She sounds like that.
She was very brave and very committed to making the world a better place in however many ways she could do on her own. So this there was no press invited to this event, but two members of the press sneaked in, and that's where all the trouble began. And my father was across town rehearsing at Lincoln Center, and he arrived at this event in the middle of it. And of course, the minute he walked into a room, all eyes turned on him, and the temperature in the room changed. He was one of those people. So when these two journalists wrote about this incident later on, one in the New York Times and the other in New York Magazine, it was all about my father and his participation in this event, and it became all about his, as if it was something that he had invented.
Right.
And then the blowback began. And it was mainly Tom Wolfe's piece that was first in New York Magazine and was called That Party at Lenny's. It was not a party, it was a fundraising event with refreshments, but never mind about that.
Right.
And then later on, that essay was incorporated into a book that was called Radical Chic and Mau Mauing the Flat Catchers, which was a different essay. And these two essays were put into one book. So that's when the misunderstanding was cemented. And Jewish people were really angry at my father because the Black Panthers were considered to be anti-Zionist. And so then there were picketers outside our building. The Jewish Defense League was picketing for a long time in front of our building, and it was only in the 1980s when my father saw his FBI file through the Freedom of Information Act. Only then did he discover that they were utterly infiltrated by FBI plants.
And of course, he played many times in Israel too, right?
Of course. He was there when in 1948 playing for
the
soldiers.
Exactly.
And the hate mail that my father received as a result of this fundraiser was also written.
And it hurt your family had to FBI. Go through emotionally, especially your father. I'm sorry, your mother, right? She, I mean, the pressure put on her on from that episode.
It was terrible.
It was terrible. And really
you know,
impacted.
There were many, many friends and family members who were furious at my mother for having had that fundraiser. And so she caught a lot of flack. And it was less hard on my father because he could leave New York and go conduct in Europe and sort of escape the situation. But my mother was firmly stuck in the whole thing. And it really took it out of her.
Well, that was part of the incredible polarization of the time. And I wish so much he would be around today. And I know he would be joining in so many of the movements, Poor People's Campaign, and so many of the other movements that are going on.
So many.
And speaking out also much more humanely and rationally about what's going on in the Middle East and Israel, Palestine, and so on. But we've only got a couple more minutes here. And this has just been a total delight, and I know for our audience and myself. This book is a very important accomplishment for you, and isn't it? It's a way of really putting a lot of things together.
Yeah, I never wrote a book before, so that
really?
Was a really big deal for me.
Right.
I always dreamed of writing a book, but I never even dared let myself have the dream because I didn't think I could do it. So I'm still pinching myself.
And you should. It's been incredibly well received. It's gotten great reviews. It has been.
It has been.
And our audience needs to pick that up. And it's just been an incredible delight to have
And
you.
Perhaps I should explain where the title came from.
Please do, in the last minute we have here.
In second grade, my classmate Lisa used to tease me, and her nickname for me to tease me was Famous Father Girl.
Oh my.
So I decided to use that for my title. Because I like it because it's a little bit rude. It kind of tweaks you on the nose.
Yeah. Well, you're Famous Father, and you are famous. You touched us all tremendously in this
thank you.
Show. So thank you so much,
Thanks
Jamie.
For having me on the program.
Thank you. Thank you again so much. And thank you all for watching The Radical Imagination this week. We're going to leave you with a couple of excerpts from West Side Story.
Great.
This is Jim Vrettos for The Radical Imagination. Actually, as a kid, I was called Jamie, too. So, Jamie, thank you so very
fellow
much.
Fellow Jamie.
Fellow Jamie. Thank you again. See you next week on The Radical Imagination.
The only comment I have is, strangely enough, you wouldn't think I'd have any comment for strings in a piece like this, but I do, that the articulation, when you have aren't there places where I don't hear that articulation from you the way I hear it from grass people? And it's important, otherwise I wouldn't have written string parts for this. It's not just a jazz band, in other words.
That's true. And whenever it gets really jazzy, the strings just tend to give up. And
in spite of the fact that we have this great genius for his trumpet playing, we still need the sun as an octave higher, and so on. Okay. So, from the top.
Here we go. Dance at the Gym. The intro.
Blues take 55.
Need help
during
those answers.
This is very weak. Later on, we do need trumpets on those.
Great. Yeah.
What wasn't together at bar 31?
What? That's impossible. It's really impossible. I never heard anything so together in my life.
Go on.
What else?
We can bring up the trombones at that first place. Yes.
What else?
We need, on bar 7, we really need a big, strong trombone.
How big do you want it? I mean,
bigger, that's all. It's just it's just sort of covered by the high trumpets. Can we try one more?
All right, try one.
We can live with it. Maybe fix that trombone place in the mix, and just
do the second half. You want to save lips.
We know that you just weren't ready for it, and you readjusted your mics, and don't Give us excuse. We know. All right. Now, have you done your homework this time? So we'll have to do it again. And don't give us as mere-skite excuses that we're not together.
That's right. 158. Here we go. Let's roll. Dance at the gym. Take 56.